Good morning and a very warm welcome to all of you. Welcome to our Sunday service. Thank you for streaming in this morning to the majority of all of you. Also, welcome this morning to our coaches. They are cheering us on this morning in the auditorium, and we trust God for a wonderful time with him and with you. So what's going to happen today is I'm going to share a few announcements. And then after that, we'll have a time of tithes and offerings, and then I'm going to give over to the worship team. And then after that, share and continue with our series of Nehemiah, the restoration of a city. So with our announcements, just want to say it's going so well with our food project in Wallasdean. Can you guys please pray for us? There's some unrest and riots in the area for the past weeks, and it's just it's not good for the team and the children there. We feed plus minus 250 children every day, Monday to Fridays, and you can still help us by donating some of the food that they need at the Suspur in Glengarry, and you can go to our website just to get some information with regards to that. Again, we're still in lockdown, level 2. Interesting, church is not on the radar of the government. We are not even on level 1. It's even after that that we will be able to connect in a big group like we've done before. But we are still connecting in our small group and life group environments. If you want to be part of a life group, you are so welcome to send us an email, infohub@oakhill.org.za. Also, how you can communicate with us and with the family and with what we are up to and what we are doing, please go and download our app, our Oakhill app. It's the way to stay in touch with us. You can connect to our live services, our website, our We Not Me page, as well as a whole lot of other amazing resources. Part of our worship at Oakhill is to bless God with our tithes and offerings. A few ways we can do that: by a snap scan or zapper. Or if you want to do pay fast, you can send a mail to finances@oakhill.org.za. But before we do that, let's just pray. Father, I want to thank you today. Thank you that this is the day that you have made, and we will rejoice and be glad in that. Father, thank you that we can focus our attention to you in the next half hour, 45 minutes, Father, and worship you and love you and just declare our dependence upon you. And I ask that in the wonderful name of Jesus. Amen.
Wherever you are online, thank you for allowing us into your house this morning. I trust that God will meet you where you're at this morning. So grab a cup of coffee, whatever you're busy with, and let's worship together.
Ever heard, no one could ever comprehend.
dreaming, God in my dreaming, you put a song in my soul. God in the working, God I'm believing, you'll do the impossible. You're not done yet, no eye. No eye has ever seen, no ear has ever heard, no one could ever comprehend. Your word will be enough, your promise we will trust, greater things are still ahead. You're not done yet. Right now, you're doing a new thing right now. God, let your glory come down. Don't hold back, don't hold back. 'Cause you're up to something right now. You're doing a new thing right now. God, let your glory come.
Awake my soul and sing. sing his praise aloud. Oh, wake my soul and sing his praise aloud, sing his praise aloud.
Father, we thank you that we can worship you today, Father. We thank you that we can fix our attention and our focus on you. We worship you. Thank you that you are not done yet with us, Father. You believe in us, Father. You believe in where we are, Father. You want people to come closer to you, Father. And we love you this morning in the wonderful name of Jesus. Amen. Welcome at Oakhill this morning. We are busy with a series, Nehemiah, a restoration of a city. And I really feel that it actually is prophetically, it declares where we are at as a people, because we're in the middle of a pandemic. The coronavirus has forever changed the way we do things and put us at an interesting place in life. If you have not asked yourself the question, why am I here? I think you need to take a few pills. Because during this time, it's a question, God, who I am? Who am I? What am I supposed to do? How do I live? How do I not live? How do I do things? And I know it's difficult for a lot of us, and I know that we go through extreme times, but I'm trusting God for great opportunities that will come out of this. And because of great opportunities, always with great opportunities, there is also great opposition. And this morning, I'm going to talk about opposition, because we all face opposition. If you do not face opposition, you're not living. You're not a Christian, because you know what? Whenever God wants to build something, you will always get opposition on the other side of the table, and his name is Satan, or the devil himself, and he tries to bark at us. He tries to actually destroy us, the word says, wants to kill and destroy us. But you know what? He's just actually barking at us. And this morning we're going to learn or remind ourselves again what tactics the devil use, what tactics the opposition use to get you to a place of, and we're going to talk about the effects of opposition. Sometimes when you don't look out for it, it's extreme discouragement, fatigue, and doubt, and unbelief, and anxiety. And then at the end, we're going to talk about how do we handle or resist the opposition in the way that God wants us to do that. One of the great tests in the kingdom of God is how to handle opposition. Do we panic under pressure? Do we get all uptight and lose your temper? Ek wens ons kon 'n vlieg op mekaar se muur gewees het in hierdie tyd om sekere goedes raak te sien. When you press that little red button inside of you, I wonder what's coming out. Is it love and patience and kindness, or is daar 'n paar ander goedjies wat daar uitklim met tye? We become discouraged and sometimes even give up. What do? You know, part of our job description as a Christian includes putting up with attacks. So in the next 22 minutes, I'm going to talk about the tactics of opposition, and then I'm going to talk about the effects of opposition and what is the right way to handle opposition. Now, let's quickly start with the tactics. And this is what we need to look out for. And we experience that, all of us. I'm going to go to Nehemiah 4, because that's the chapter that we are in. Now remember, just to give you a little bit of background again, Nehemiah was sent by God to Jerusalem to help the Jewish nation rebuild and restore the city to its original intent. intent with the walls, the restoration of the wall around the city, and the whole nation came together and they built that wall in record time of 52 days. They've tried to rebuild the walls years and years before that, never could get it right, but because Nehemiah followed the restoration process set out by God, they restored that wall in record time, 52 days. And if you've missed some of the series, I think we're in the fifth or sixth week in that, you are welcome to go onto our website to go and watch on demand. It'll bless you. So I'm going to start with verse 1. When Sanballat, now Sanballat is an evil guy. He had some guys around him. Tobias was one of them. When he heard that we were rebuilding the wall, he became angry and was greatly incensed, and he ridiculed the Jews in the presence of the associates and the army of Samaria. And he said, "What are those feeble Jews doing? Will they restore their wall? Will they offer sacrifices? Will they finish in a day? Can they bring stones back to life from those heaps of rubble, burnt as they are?" Now, Tobiah, the Ammonite, who was his sidekick, who was by his side, said, "What are they building? Even if a fox climbed upon it, he would break down their wall of stones." I want to say to you, the first tactic that the devil uses is ridicule, this bespotting. It goes out and it makes fun of you. And we have clear examples of this here. It's a powerful, effective tool, and it's actually still working today. There are actually books that people write about psychological warfare in the business environment, how to out-psych your competitor. And in the kingdom, sometimes we feel that that's what's happening with us, around us. People continue ridicule the church, puts it down, argues, makes fun of God's people, characterizes Christians as weak and ignorant, fanatical people. Some pastors are wimps and crooks, and you can go on and on and on. It's constant ridicule. You know what happens? When people, when they do that, they try and take the power away from you. They try and intimidate you so that you feel weak and they can feel better about themselves. They want to make you small by saying those things around you. There's a saying that goes on, small people make other people smaller so that they can feel bigger and better about themselves. We need to be careful, because you know what happens is that the devil actually comes. We all have strengths and weaknesses. And you know what? It is okay to have weaknesses. But people will come, and the devil will come, and he will put his finger on that weakness and makes you feel like a failure or an idiot. In other words, ridicule is so effective. Why? Because it attacks your self-worth. You feel at the end of the day, I'm worthless. And it's just because the enemy, it says there, he became very angry and greatly incensed. In other words, the devil raak woedend. Die mense om jou raak woedend, because they don't want you to succeed. When someone sees you, you are actually working on yourself and you are restoring your life and actually you are succeeding in that. They know that they have lost, so they will get very angry and they will try anything to what? To sow fear in your life. People who ridicule you are usually just afraid. They're afraid that you're going to succeed. Look what they were saying. It's name calling. He was saying, "Those feeble Jews." He implies that they have a selfish motive. He makes fun of their beliefs. He actually overstates their case. All of these are typical tools of ridicule. He says, "Are they going to build it in one day?" They never said that they're going to build it in one day. But you guys understand where I'm going with this. You know what's so amazing about ridicule? It's also contagious. You can't keep it for yourself. And then all of a sudden, the sidekick being up next to you, he now gets attacked by that spirit, and then all of a sudden Tobias, he goes on. He adds where Sanballat ends, and he says, "What are they building? Even if a fox climbed upon it, he would break down their wall of stone." I want to say there's always people that will ridicule you if somebody else takes the lead. Those are cowards, but they're going to try and do it again and again and again. It's important for us to discern when that comes our way. Second tactic that the devil uses is not just to ridicule you, but it's to give resistance. This weerstand. He will stand up, and in actual fact, what happened with them is there was organized resistance. Look in verse 6, it says, "We rebuilt the wall until it reached half of its height, and the people worked with all their heart. But Sanballat, Salvirai Anna, Lut, and Tobiah, and the Arabs, and the Ammonites, and the men of Ashdod heard that the repairs to the wall of Jerusalem had gone ahead and the gaps were being closed. They were very angry. They all plotted together to come and fight against Jerusalem and stir up trouble against it." In other words, that scripture says it's organized resistance. Instead of just a couple of critics, we have a conspiracy here. We see that Sanballat has gathered all the disgruntled parties and he wants to resist the rebuilding of that wall. You see there, Sanballat and the Samaritans were in the north, the Arabs in the south, Tobiah and the Ammonites in the east, and the men of Ashdod were on the other side. Now, let me just also say something. Have you seen how negative people tend to sort of just gravitate together? That's why it's important for you to hang out with the right people that God wants you to hang out with, because what's that saying? The birds of a feather flock together, and we see that in life. You know what restoration may you find in life, and suddenly everything starts to go wrong in your life. You get a tire that burst, and then you get a medical bill all of a sudden the week after that you did not budget for. And then all of a sudden, one of your close relationships goes south and you ask yourself the question, what's going on? Man, we need to ask God for discernment, because in this process, this is what's happening. In this time, Lizette and myself, we said to one another, let's over-communicate in this time. Because when ridicule comes and when resistance comes, let's just see and call it by its name. So sometimes we will look at one another and I'm saying to Lizette, lovey, this is a setup. Are we going to fight about this now? This is a setup. We need to see it for what it is. Because you know what? The Jews felt totally surrounded by the enemy. Maybe you feel totally surrounded this morning by that. But I want to say to you that God is with you. He's just barking at you. He wants to sow unbelief in your corner. Even although you may find that it's around you, let's fight it. Amen? The third tactic that he used is, and this is a huge one, starts to spread rumors. Did you see? Have you noticed? And then it ends up all in gossip. And in die Christen kringe is dit nogals redelijk interessant, daai ookie. In verse 11 and 12, it says, "They also our enemies said." Now, hear what they sow. This is the rumor that they are sowing the whole time. "Before they know it," that's now the Jews, "before they know it or see us, we will be right there among them and we will work to kill them and put an end to their work." The quickest way to spread a rumor is to feed on people's fears. It's just to feed on to get you to a place where they attack you with that, and then you have all sorts of fears going on. The fact is, that enemy did not have the power to even attack the Jews. But you know what? They started spreading the rumors that we are around you. You are surrounded. We are going to kill you. You're not going to make it. Sometimes, in our mind, that's the game that we play. I'm not good enough. I've got a fear of failure, fear of man, fear of rejection. What's going on around me? I can remember, guys, can you remember when we opened up this church in the first time in, can't remember the date, where a few guys in our community started spreading rumors about our zoning, that we are not zoned for the correct purposes, and we were on the front pages of the Tiger Burger. And I mean, in our minds, they tried to sow total confusion, and they wanted to resist us by doing all those things. But at the end of the day, we call it for what it was, and here we are. So, two characteristics of rumors. Rumors are normally spread by the people closest to you. So just be careful of that. And sometimes people don't even, they don't even have a bad intention. It's like when somebody said to me the other day, "You look so depressed." You know, and then after lunch, someone else said to me, "But you're so white in your face." And then because of that, I'm thinking, "Well, frack, what's wrong with me?" You know, but there's nothing wrong with me. It's just, it was just a day. But that's a tactic that the devil wants to use. If Satan can get somebody inside of the camp saying it can't be done, then he's got a major victory. Because what does he want to do? He wants to infiltrate the ranks. Yeah, Oakhill's not going to make it. We are not getting together. There's just an elite coming together on a Sunday. Guys, it's not like that. It's very bad for me and sad for me that we need to celebrate in the way that we do. But you know what? This is what God wants for us at the moment. We need to be very careful of what we listen to and what we open up our eyes and ears to. And then the second characteristic of a rumor is it's exaggerated when they are repeated. It says there, "Then they told us 10 times over." When you hear a rumor, please, you can hear it, but just don't swallow it. Because when you swallow it, it goes around and it comes around. It's like people will say, "Louis, are you still, what's happening? Because you're giving accountancy classes in the afternoons, and but you're supposed to be the pastor." And then the next day you hear another rumor, and then I've heard somebody say to me, "But did you hear that Pastor Louis got corona? And is he self-isolating?" And I'm like, what is going on? Am I still Louis, you know? And I suppose in your life, it really happens like that. Don't fall for those tactics, because you know what? It leads me to the effect of opposition. And that saddens me, because I've realized that all of us go through that in life. The effect of opposition, the major effect is discouragement. You feel discouraged. In verse 10 and 11, "Meanwhile, the people in Judah said," it's now the Jews, they're saying, "the strength of the laborers is giving out, and there is so much rubble that we cannot rebuild the wall. Also, our enemies will attack us." You know what's amazing about discouragement? When is discouragement most likely to occur in your life? It says there in verse 6, "So we rebuilt the wall until all of it reached half of its height." Discouragement comes halfway into a project in our lives. I wonder how many half-finished projects around your house you can find. And you know, there's a saying that says, when you swim from this side of the ocean to the other side, when you are halfway there and you get discouraged and you've got no strength, what are you going to decide? Are you just going to go back and not do that? Because the strength that you need to go back and what you need to go forward is exactly the same. So sometimes it's just see it for what it is. The causes of discouragement is, number one, is fatigue. Listen, it says the strength of the laborers is giving out. It's frustration. There was so much rubble. Failure. We cannot rebuild the wall, it says. And fear. The Jews were saying the enemies will attack us. With fatigue, I want to say to you, sometimes the enemy wants to get you busy with all sorts of dead works. And then you work at it, and you work at it, and you work at it, and you become so tired, but it's because you are busy with the wrong stuff. That's why it's so important for us to be connected to God. Frustration, I think frustration is usually a matter of perception, because actually the piles are getting smaller, the rubble, but they don't see that. Their perception saw something else and they became frustrated. Failure, we cannot rebuild the wall. You know what? Failure actually must be qualified as a perception. We all fail. Learn out of that. It's actually great to fail sometimes, because then you know you're not going to make the same mistake the next time it happens. So the opposition always has two goals. One of them is to hinder God's word, and then it is to stop God's work. Okay, so now let's get the negative stuff behind us and go over to what is our response supposed to be like. And I think the first one is just to rely on God. In this time, it's to sit with Him. The place where you go to that discouragement because of all the ridicule and the resistance and the rumors, and I'm not going to make it, and I don't have a salary, Father, and I don't, no, and it's all those things. It's like, just come to me, He asks, because He's not done with you yet. We sang that this morning. Rely on Him. Start praising Him. Pray. Get connected to Him. Nehemiah was praying. He was saying in verse 4 and 5, "Hear, O God, that we are despised. Turn their insults back over their heads and give them over as plunder in the land of captivity. Do not cover their guilt or blot out their sins from your sight. They have thrown insults in the face of the builder." It's okay to be angry. Nehemiah was angry. Just do not sin in your anger, says the word of God. It's okay to be angry. And you know what? Don't take your anger out on name calling and going to that person and have a screaming match or whatever is going on. Come to God and pray and confess and admit, "I'm angry, God. You are my vindicator, God. God, won't you deal with them, Lord? Go to Him." Let me also just say that we've realized some demonic forces or activity or a fight, it's not yours. You don't have the strength to do that. That's why at times it's good to come together with the twos and threes and pray and rely on God and start to admit that, "Father, I can't do this, but I know that You can." Proverbs 26:4 says, "Do not answer a fool according to his folly, or you will be like him yourself." Don't answer back at times. I think that's dumb. You've got to rely on God, and that's what Nehemiah does. He hears this initial ridicule, and he basically ignores it, and he goes to God, and he says, "God, won't you just hear our prayers?" The second thing is, now that we've prayed and we are still praying, is we need to now act on that. One of the ways that you can act on that is to face the devil, is to respect your enemy and to have a look at him in his face. In verse 9 it says, "But we prayed to our God and we posted a guard day and night to meet this threat." In other words, we can't just lay in bed and say, "Father, please protect my house," but you don't want to go and lock the door. You need to be spiritual and practical at the same time. God wants us. There's another scripture in 2 Corinthians, "Don't be ignorant of Satan's devices." He wants to make you and feel you discouraged, disappointment, doubt, and division in your life. Don't be suspicious, but ask God for discernment. Ask Him, "Father, in situations where I'm in, will You please just help me?" And then the third one, which is a great one for me, is reinforce your weak points. That's what they did. They didn't just pray or posted the guard there. It says, "Then, therefore, I stationed some of the people behind the lowest points of the wall at the exposed places, posting them by families with their swords, spears, and bows." Reinforce the lower points, not where the wall is 10 meters high, but at places where it's half a meter, put the guards down there. In your own life, it's important to understand, where is your strength and your weakness. Where are your strengths and weaknesses? And you know what? When you are weak, is to reinforce your weaknesses by getting the people around you that can help you and support you even in this time. The word that I'm actually looking for is to be vulnerable. People see vulnerability as a weakness. I see it as one of the best strengths that you have is to be vulnerable and not think that you can make all of it. There are certain places where you need people around you to help you. The guard needs to stand at your wall. People need to be there to support you. It's pride that keeps us away from the one another's in life. Do you know the weak points in your personality, in your business, perhaps in your family, in your marriage? God wants us to be vulnerable and to reinforce that area. Listen, verse 16. From that day on, half of my men did the work while the other half were equipped with spears and bows and armor. The officers posted themselves behind all the people of Judah who were building the wall. Those who carried materials did the work with one hand and held a weapon in the other. Each of the builders wore his sword at his side as he worked, but the man who sounded the trumpet stayed with me. I said to the nobles and officials, "The work is extensive and spread out, and we are widely separated from each other along the wall. Whenever you hear the sound of the trumpet, join us there, and our God will fight for us." Keep the lines of communication open. So amazing. He posted them family by family so that the one family member is not working on the other side of the wall and thinking the whole time and worrying about where it's like we are family. They're together and they are looking at the wall and they are building the wall with one with a sword in their right hand and a brick in the other hand, and that's how they did it. In Corona time, our church structure completely changed. But you know what I'm so thankful for is for the different families inside of the church. Structured in a way that you can get together family by family in your life groups and connecting with one another and still strengthening one another and keep the communication lines open so that when you hear the trumpet, your group will know what to do. And I'm so thankful for all of you. And that's why I say it's so important to be in a life group, because that's where we connect. Never fight a fight alone. That's the purpose of church. That's the purpose of support. God never meant us to be lone rangers. He wants us to be family. And then the last one that I want to touch on is to refuse to quit. Verse 15 says, when our enemies heard that we were aware of their plot and that God had frustrated it, we all returned to the wall, each to his own work. Does not matter where we are in life, God wants us not to quit. Must be in our minds, we are not going to quit and we're not going to listen to what the devil wants to say. So, to end off this morning, let's not fall for the trap. Let me just also say one thing. It's important for us to know that opposition comes, and you need to actually embrace that. Because if you understand what the devil is doing and why he's doing that, it's just so easy to overcome that, because the fullness of God dwells within us richly. Don't fall for ridicule. Don't fall for resistance. Don't fall for rumors. Because when we fall for that, it's going to bring you to a place of total discouragement, fatigue, frustration, doubt, and unbelief. Rather, rely on God and act on that truth with faithful works. And in the process, reinforce your weaknesses. Get support behind you. And allow God for you to say, I will refuse to quit, because greater is he that is in me than he that is in this world. Amen. Let's pray. Father, thank you for every person this morning. Father, thank you that I know that in this time we face a lot of opposition, Father, and sometimes it discourages us, Lord. Will you help us to learn out of that, Father, and help us to rely on you, Father, because we know we are weak, but when we are weak, you are strong, Father. And I pray for every individual in this time, Father, that you will strengthen us and give us the grace to walk this through, Father God, because we know we are victorious at the end of the day. And the work that you have started within us, you will bring that to completion. And I ask that in the wonderful name of Jesus. Amen. God bless you. We love you. I hope you have a fantastic week, and we'll see you again next Sunday. Remember, Wednesday night live, not next Wednesday, the week after that, the first Wednesday of September. God bless you. We love you.